We are joined this morning by Suzy Khachaturyan, Policy Analyst of the Budget and Tax Center, which is a project of the NC Justice Center, and Heba Atwa, Policy Advocate of the Budget and Tax Center. We are grateful for their presence here as they can help us to better understand the latest budget and tax movements and how we as people of faith and conscience can advocate for positive legislation. Suzy and Heba, thank you for being with us this morning. We look forward to learning from you.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yes, thank you. Let me see if I can share my slides here. Okay, someone can just give me a thumbs up or a thumbs down. Okay, perfect. Thank you, Sean and Heba. We're excited to be with you today. I'm gonna show you our quick agenda for the next hour. So I'm gonna give you an overview of the budget process and sort of where we are in the current moment. And we'll talk about some decisions about federal funding, because that, which you probably already know, is a particularly big component of our work this year as we try to tackle COVID-19 and the ongoing pandemic. And then I'm gonna turn it to my colleague Heba Atwa to talk about the COVID-19 recovery and tax policy and more of what's happening on certain bills.
Suzy, can I just say something real quick? I wanted to remind all of our people here this morning that as you have questions, please put them in the chat box and we will get to those during our Q&A session. So please ask your questions. Sorry to interrupt, Suzy. Thank you.
No problem at all. Thanks for saying that. All right. And I will also say that because I'm sharing my screen, it's going to be hard for me to see chat, or, you know, if there's any technical difficulty, someone feel free to unmute and interrupt me because I won't be able to see what's going on. All right. So jumping into some of what we at the Budget and Tax Center think are key choices in the budget process and are important to sort of set the stage as we think about this ongoing legislative session that we're already in. So throughout the budget process, we like to focus on these three key questions to really center our work, and we'll walk through them a bit in a bit more detail, but really thinking about how much taxes are we generating as a state and who is paying those taxes? How do we divide up dollars across different budget areas, and where do we actually spend the money? Excuse me. How can we actually target that to communities? So kind of diving into each of those, to the previous slide's question about how much taxes do we collect as a state and who is paying those taxes, we rely on research from our partners at the Institute on Taxation and Economic Policy, who produce this analysis for us. So when we take a look at all state and local taxes as a share of income, we see that those with the lowest incomes, which you can see on the left bar with the bottom 20, those with the lowest incomes pay the highest share of their annual income toward state and local taxes. Whereas on the right-hand side, you can see those with the highest incomes pay the smallest share. So when we think about where our state revenues are coming from, we often say that our state tax code is regressive, or that it's upside down. And so this is like the chart that basically we're referring to when we say that. And Heba's going to come back to this this idea later on in the presentation. So now when we think about, or rather, one of the key analyses that we produce and that is often requested of us is to sort of put into context the most recent budget, as well as budget proposals as they're being released, to compare investments or proposed investments to the size of the state's economy. And so here you see that investments as a share of state income sharply decreased during the Great Recession. You can see that here in 2009. And so this is typical during recessions for states, because most states, I believe it's 49 states, have balanced budget requirements, which just means that we can't spend more money than we have in a current year. We can't go into debt within each budget year, with few exceptions that I won't go into. So what's key here is that while our investments dipped, and you would expect that, they've also remained low and have even declined since then. So now, when we look at the past 45 years, which is the data that are displayed on this chart, which is most of the data that's available for North Carolina, we're now at an all-time low in terms of our state spending relative to our state economy. And this is concerning to us. So here you can see how the state allocates the different dollars that we have. This reflects our general fund revenues. And so the general fund is basic, just another way of saying that it's sort of the state's main bank account. So you can see that most of our money goes to K through 12 education, 39%, followed by health and human services, followed by higher education and justice and public safety and so on. Often you'll see K through 12 and higher education grouped together to show that education accounts for over half of the state budget. So when we sort of take a step back, given these three sort of principles that we use to approach our budget work and our budget analysis at the Budget and Tax Center, we also know that what's currently going on in North Carolina, the status quo, is not working, right? So the current underinvestments and inequitable distribution of public dollars are really undermining our shared goals. And so this results in the missed foundation for long-term success, economic success. It has unintended consequences for all of us, because we know, I think the pandemic has especially highlighted how each of our well-being is connected to each other. This results in unequal opportunities in communities. And I won't go into this in this presentation, but it also shifts a lot of responsibilities from the state to local governments. And so this can undermine the public good and really the pursuit of equity. So thinking more about the budget process itself, just to lay out some key components that that we should keep in mind, just a reminder that the state operates on a biennial budget. So every 2 years, the state puts together a two-year budget. That's how it's supposed to work. We'll talk more about how that has broken down in recent years, but every 2 years, they create a two-year budget, and then in the in-between years, they come back and consider revisions to those budgets. Odd years are, of course, long sessions, and so being 2021, we're in a long session, and it technically started in, I believe it was January 11th. It was sometime in like early to mid-January, and I think it's expected to last of the majority of the year, what is currently what we're hearing. And so what this means is that without a final budget, and this is based on legislation that the General Assembly passed a few years ago, without a final budget, the state reverts to prior year spending with just very few exceptions. And we published a report on this, and what the lack of the state budget meant 2 years ago, when the governor vetoed, you'll remember the governor vetoed the General Assembly's budget due in large part to the absence of Medicaid expansion, as well as continued underinvestments in education. And so that meant that we reverted to prior year spending with the exception of the mini budgets that they passed, which we know is sort of a piecemeal approach to really to what the state needs. So just to sort of, once again, sort of update you all perhaps on what you already know about where we are in the budget process. We know that step three on this slide is the governor's budget proposal. And so that was released several weeks ago. And so we're now on step four, where the budget process is happening in each chamber. This year, the Senate will release their budget proposal first, and then the House will release theirs. So currently, that's not a public process yet, but we know that they're working on it behind behind the scenes, thinking about the upcoming, the remainder of the budget process. So again, we're on step four. So once the Senate releases their budget, they will start to meet in different appropriations subcommittees. And they actually already are on other, on some other bills, and they're, you know, educating new lawmakers about the budget process. So those substantive areas include things like education and healthcare. And then after that, the House and the Senate will need to come to an agreement on a single budget bill. And then as with all bills, it'll go to the governor. He will either sign it into law, let it become law without a signature, or he'll veto the bill. The General Assembly can then try to override the veto if they have enough votes to do so. But of course, that's more difficult to do than the original vote in the General Assembly, because veto overrides require a supermajority or two-thirds of the votes in each chamber for those present, versus just a simple majority. So while this is still generally happening, many things have broken down in the past decade in particular, including a lack of transparency around the process, and really, you know, sort of they do most of the negotiations behind closed doors. It's not a public process as it's intended to be. And they sort of come out with a bill and then try to put it up for a vote rather quickly. And so what they've also done in recent years is that the General Assembly's leadership, again, behind closed doors, comes to an agreement on an arbitrary top line number for how much money they're going to spend. Last time it was $24 billion. And then they decided how to divvy up the money across the different budget areas that I showed you earlier. And so we think that's problematic, because we really should be starting with the need and then thinking about how we can equitably generate revenue to meet those needs. And Heba will talk more about that. Just a graphic showing the lack of transparency. This is the, at the bottom, you can see the report that we published in 2019 about no final budget, no accountability, and highlights the different piecemeal budgets. And so in thinking more about this legislative session, look at my time. Like I mentioned at the outset, federal dollars are playing a particularly big role, and I'll talk more about that in a moment. But the other thing that we've tried to highlight in the past several months as the Budget and Tax Center and with partners is this really massive unreserved cash balance. So this admittedly isn't slightly outdated. I didn't update this screenshot, but suffice it to say that we have a lot of money with, you know, it's still about $5 billion sitting in our unreserved cash balance. And this is completely separate from the state's what's called the rainy day fund. The rainy day fund has very specific rules for how money gets in and how money gets out. The unreserved cash balance is literally just money sitting in the bank that we could appropriate today with a simple majority. And so this, combined with the fact that we have a huge influx of federal dollars that are new federal dollars that are about to come in, means that we can afford to invest, despite a lot of the messaging that you'll hear. And, you know, we know that COVID-19 has made our existing needs even more pressing. So I'll just highlight some of the major federal aid packages that were passed that included provisions that either came to the state or went directly to North Carolinians or businesses. So we know that in March of last year, it was over a year ago, the Families First Coronavirus Relief Act was passed. That was sort of the first major component. After that was the CARES Act. Sometime, I believe it was a couple months later in the summer, the Paycheck Protection Program, or the PPP bill, was passed. That was a smaller bill compared to the others. In December, I believe it was December 28th of 2020, the Coronavirus Response and Relief Supplemental Appropriations Act was passed. The short name for that is the Coronavirus, the Consolidated Appropriations Act, which is still sort of being rolled out. And then, of course, the American Rescue Plan Act, which was signed into law on March 11th of this year, and that I have spent many, many hours in the last month trying to analyze. So this is one of the analyses that we produced after the passage of the CARES Act. We've not yet updated it in this graphical form, but I just thought it did a good job of highlighting all of the different issue-specific funding that were available, with, of course, the Coronavirus Relief Fund. You can see the $4 billion. These are all of the allocations that came directly to North Carolina. And so last year we saw the General Assembly, most of its activity was around allocating the Coronavirus Relief Fund dollars, which for short are the CRF dollars. And this is available on our website, and I'm happy to share a link to that fact sheet if folks are interested. And like I said, we're producing additional analysis around the American Rescue Plan, but we are still waiting for some of the official allocations coming to North Carolina, as well as the guidance on exactly how the funds can be spent and how they can be spent. So this is my last slide, and then I'll turn it to my colleague Heba. I've mentioned the federal bills that are happening that include the CARES Act, different block grant and other issue-specific funds, the American Rescue Plan Act, just as some examples of the federal dollars that are coming in. But really it's crucial that we drive those dollars to meet community priorities and community needs. And so a lot of the onus falls on the state and the General Assembly in particular to make those decisions about where dollars should go. Additionally, the local governments, so counties, metropolitan cities, as well as smaller towns and other non-county governments, are also receiving some dollars. Also, the state has allocated some dollars to local governments because we know that a lot of choices about where money goes are also made at the local level. So I just wanted to acknowledge that that all three are important. And so we're doing work to understand what's happening at the federal level and at the local level, and how we can inform some of the decisions, that are happening there as well as at the state level. So with that, I'll turn it to my colleague, Heba.
Thanks, Suzy. And thank you again so much for having us. I'm really excited to talk to you about some tax policy proposals. So Suzy talked about how foundational tax policy is to ensure an equitable economy, and also to ensure that we have the resources that we need to adequately invest in crucial programs and services that will help us recover from the economic impact of the pandemic. So I'd like to start with some context. If we go back in time and we think about 2019 and we think about what was happening right before COVID-19 and the pandemic, we know that about 42% of North Carolinians fell below the living income standard. The living income standard is a measure like the federal poverty level, but instead the living income standard measures what people need, what a family needs to make ends meet. So we're not talking about luxuries, we're talking about basic necessities, housing, childcare, food, healthcare. So 42% of us fell below the living income standard. We couldn't meet our needs. And about the same percentage, around 42%, didn't have enough liquid assets and savings to make it 3 months without income. So we know what was coming in the next few months for families. And the richest 5% of households made an average of 28 times more than the poorest 20% of households in our state. So fast forward a little bit to the pandemic. And we know that hardship was widespread. Suzy, you can fast forward the slide. We know that hardship has been widespread during the COVID-19 downturn. And the data show that millions of North Carolinians found it and are finding it difficult to pay for usual household expenses. And especially in terms of inequity, Black people and multiracial people reported the greatest level of difficulty. So what this data suggests is that the economic inequality that existed before the pandemic will likely continue to widen unless we sort of shift and we take robust action to address these persistent disparities. If we move on to the next slide. So right now we're experiencing what's called a K-shaped recovery. And basically what that means is that we are not all finding ourselves in the same circumstance as we recover from this pandemic. So the recession was effectively over for the best paid North Carolinians by the end of 2020, but our worst paid workers are still feeling the economic impacts of the COVID-19 pandemic. So to give an example, basically by the end of the year, all of the jobs lost during COVID-19 in the professional and business services sector had been recovered, while 1/5 of the pre-pandemic jobs in leisure and hospitality are still missing. So issues like childcare, low wages, and the ability to work remotely or the inability to work remotely has impacted who is most likely to recover and has been able to recover quickly. So Suzy mentioned our upside down tax code. And she mentioned that our tax code currently asks the top earners to pay less as a share of their income than taxpayers with poverty level incomes. So I wanna give again a little bit of context. There were some tax changes ushered in 2013. To give you a snapshot, those tax changes have meant a move from a 3-tiered personal income tax to a flat rate, a reduction in personal income tax, a reduction in corporate income tax rates, and the earned income tax credit, which is a credit for working families, a working family's tax credit that provides a boost to their budgets and incomes at tax time, was allowed to expire. So by putting in place tax policies that would ask just 1% of North Carolinians to pay slightly more and reinstituting an earned income tax credit, we can begin to invest in a more equitable tax code and a just recovery for everyone, and we can begin to mitigate our inequitable tax code. So I want to talk to you now about some tax proposals that are in the General Assembly. So Senate Bill 710 and House Bill 556 provide that first step in addressing North Carolina's upside down tax code. So basically these bills put in place again that graduated income tax rate that I mentioned by taxing income above $500,000 a year at higher rates up to the current state constitutional cap of 7%, which puts us in line with neighboring states, and by raising the tax rate on corporate profits from 2.5% to 5%. So there is widespread support for this across the state. And then in addition to Senate Bill 710 and House Bill 556, there's also SB Senate Bill 576 and House Bill 499, the so-called Recovery Rebate for Working Families Acts. Those are companion bills in both the Senate and the House. So the recovery rebate is a state-level tax credit targeted at middle and low-income workers, styled after the federal earned income tax credit. So eligibility is dependent and varies dependent on family size and on income. So to give you a little more information, between 850,000 and 900 lower income families would benefit from the recovery rebate, receiving an average of about $500 back at tax time. So we know from the decades of research that has been done on the earned income tax credit that those dollars that lower income families, low and middle income families receive at tax time, that are returned to them at tax time, have a real substantial positive impact on the health and well-being of both parents and children. And this significant amount of research over decades has shown us that families that benefit from working families tax credits perform better in school, children are more likely to attend college, they're more likely to earn more as adults. And working family tax credits are also associated with improved physical and mental health for both parents and children, improved maternal and infant health, enhanced nutrition, and community well-being. So to give you kind of a number as an example, there's also a positive impact on low birth weight. So in North Carolina, almost 400 babies annually, if a generous and refundable tax credit for working families like the recovery rebate was instituted at the state level, close to 400 babies could avoid low birth weight annually. And these are babies that are at the highest risk. Their mothers are at the highest risk of having low birth weight babies. And we know that, of course, low birth weight has really negative impacts throughout life on a child. And so we'd encourage you to take action. And oh, one thing I should mention also is that there's overwhelming support for the recovery rebate or a working tax credit for families in North Carolina. And that includes both rural areas across our state. So rural North Carolina, urban North Carolina, there's really a tremendous amount of support across the state. So we ask you to please contact your North Carolina senators and representatives and let them know that you too support tax changes like this. And yes, I am going to put the bill numbers in the chat right now. And thanks, we welcome any questions.
Thank you so much, Suzy and Heba. Lots of good information. I'm glad y'all saw the question about the bill numbers. I was trying to take notes, but it's a lot of bill numbers, right, to grasp.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, I can't remember them all. So yeah, hearing them once, I don't expect you to.
please put your questions in the chat. One of the questions that we got was in regards to the unreserved cash balance. And the question is the unreserved cash balance not allocated with the simple majority because we can't figure out where to direct the funds to?
Good question. So I think it's a really good question. The unreserved cash balance is it's just our general fund, really. It's just the amount of general fund dollars that have not been dedicated to any use. So it's basically just money sitting in our bank account that we haven't touched. And so that is, like I said, separate from the rainy day fund, which has, you know, it is the like I said, the way that money gets in and out of the rainy day fund, or the, it's also, it's technically called the savings reserve. That is dictated by statute. I believe it may even be in the North Carolina Constitution. I can't remember off the top of my head, but there are some very strict rules. But I think the issue around the unreserved balance being so large is in part due to inability to decide where the money goes. I think it also, I think there's also some ideological differences about how much money we should spend. And I think it's tied up in some other issues about, you know, whether we should spend, really any money, some might say, to invest in these different systems and in the infrastructure that we know that we need. So I think it's part of broader issues. I don't think I answered the question, but I think it touches on some of the broader challenges that we have. I'll also mention that we know, and we're digging into analysis around these bills, but there have also now been what are called Tabor bills filed in both the House and the Senate. And so technically the definition of Tabor is taxpayer bill of rights, but it's sort of deceptively named, because really Tabor bills, and Colorado, I know, is one state, I think it may be the only state, Heba, correct me if I'm wrong, that has been operating under Tabor restrictions, but really it's how we can put in the Constitution or in statute limitations on how much money we can spend. And so we see that as a very real threat. And I think it speaks to this question about, you know, whether we're spending money at all. Heba, feel free to add to that if you think I missed something.
Yeah, I wish I had a link to share about the impact of Tabor in Colorado. I don't right now. Maybe we can share that. But basically, it's been pretty disastrous. And especially in the middle of a pandemic. So we're living through right now sort of unprecedented circumstances. So this has taught us that kind of arbitrary parameters around taxation and spending can be really, really dangerous, and don't allow us the flexibility we need to invest in times of distress like now, or, you know, I'm thinking about natural disasters, all sorts of things.
Thank you. We have another question, which also has a lot of acronyms in it, which I'm sure y'all will understand. But we need money to implement Executive Order 80. Where are the discussions in the budget taking place for that? Well, I guess we'll let that question happen first, and then there's more follow-up on that.
Yeah, Susanna, can you say more about Executive Order 80? I apologize. I imagine it has something to do with environmental quality because you referenced funding for DEQ, but I apologize. I'm not aware of what Executive Order 80 is.
She says she can't unmute herself.
I can. So I'm going to do a very poor job of answering on your behalf, Susanna. So I apologize, because I'm not going to do your response justice.
Actually, she just did give me access to unmute myself.
Oh, good. Okay.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much. This presentation could not be more timely, especially after Biden's joint session address last night, where so much of this was a discussion around the budget and finance, obviously. Yes, Executive Order 80 is Governor Cooper's climate action plan for the state, essentially. And it involved, when it came out in 2018, it involved requirements of all governmental departments to look at essentially an audit, internal audit of how they were addressing climate change and had to report back to DEQ. And now with the transition of now Administrator Michael Regan at the EPA and waiting on Dion Delegati to be confirmed as the new Secretary of DEQ, we are working closely with their offices, and they are just stripped of all resources. You know, I think it was under McCrory that really came in and dismantled DEQ, even probably previously in looking at your slides, which regard to the really racketed budget reductions. And so I was wondering, in that total budget, when we looked at the graph with regards to education, you know, being a primary allocation for our resources, I didn't see any monies allocated towards governmental departments or where that fits in. I'm really new to learning about how budgets work. And so I don't know how the government is funded on itself. I guess that fits into general government, maybe. If you could tell me a little bit more about how we, because the governor is trying to get a lot of things accomplished that are going to require a lot of money. And that's why I also asked about the other funds that are just sitting there, when we know that we have major resiliency issues and climate action implementation plans that need to be implemented ASAP. Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. And thanks. Yeah, sorry for not knowing what this important executive order is. So I guess like the quick answer to your question is that DEQ falls under natural and economic resources, which is this tiny little 3% sliver of the budget. So there is lots of room for improvement here. And like I said before, I think we not only think about, you know, the ways that we're sort of divvying up the money that make up the total budget figure, but also the size of the pie, if you will. Speaking to what Heba was saying about, you know, what our total bank account looks like, which is driven by our revenue choices and how we generate revenue. To my knowledge, let me look back at your question. I'll admit that I'm not closely tracking personally environmental related spending. We do have some close partners that do that, and that sort of are one of our sort of budget advisors. Certainly there's, like I said, there's lots of room for improvement in terms of how we spend around environmental spending. I can just say quickly also that several years ago now, we published a report thinking more holistically about health and how we fund health. This was well before the pandemic, but in thinking about how, you know, climate change affects health and how, you know, environmental protections affect health, including things like lead and water testing and things like that. Oops. One of the findings was that North Carolina, also a lot of North Carolina spending, or maybe not a lot, a fair amount of North Carolina spending towards environmental protections is actually paying fees that, you know, fines basically that we get for violations of environmental protections. So again, I know that's not a full answer to your question, but I think you raise a good point about these sort of unfunded mandates that are intended to serve an important purpose, but are done without funding and without funding for infrastructure improvements that we know will help us in the long term.
Thank you. And please keep asking your questions. It's not often that you'll have tax policy experts at your disposal to ask down to the nitty gritty of what's going on. There is a question, and it may be for Susanna, it might be for y'all. Can you tell us who are your partners for spending at the Department of Environmental Quality?
I I'm not sure if I can answer that because we don't work closely with DEQ. That might be for Susanna.
Well, the good news is I love working with the Justice Center, and my partner particularly is with Al Ripley in the in income and housing, and looking at what's happening with the utilities and DEQ and all of that. So yeah, definitely want to continue this conversation. I know there's a lot of other parts of the budget. I also appreciate the connection with climate and health. And our session this afternoon is going to be around healthcare policy. So this is a great, great timing on that too. Sorry, I have so many wind chimes. I'm sorry.
I do have a question. I know everybody saw the announcement this week about Apple coming to the Triangle. And it's stunning to me to learn that we're not in line with our neighboring states with regards to the corporate tax rate. Certainly a lot of good funding to be gained by just getting in line, right? What are y'all, it's a very amoebous type question, but how drawing an apple in, how does that hurt us or help us when we're talking about looking at changing the corporate tax rate, which I would argue we need to do?
I think that's a great question. And Suzy, I would invite you to help me answer this as well. So we understand, you all might remember the tax cap fight in 2018, the constitutional amendment fight. So we understand actually that Apple did contribute to the discussion in a way that we thought was somewhat supportive of our position that a tax cap really would not be good for North Carolina. But to what extent and they did that, especially behind closed doors, I don't think we have a great sense. Is that your sense as well, Suzy?
Yes, I think so. We're still trying to understand.
And what we do know from those discussions, I can't speak to Apple specifically, but what we do know from discussions with business leaders around the 2018 tax cap fight is that we know that, of course, businesses that are thinking about coming to North Carolina or starting in North Carolina are not just concerned about tax rate. We know that they're concerned about livability, and we know that they're concerned about quality of life here for their spouses, for their children. They're thinking about infrastructure. They're thinking about the roads. They're thinking about the schools, summer programs, et cetera. So we know that it's not sort of as simple as boiling down to, they're chasing the lowest corporate tax rates. And we know that they are interested in ensuring that if they invest, generally speaking, I can't speak for Apple again, but if they invest in this area, they want to make sure that we are also investing in ourselves. I will say that I have not read the specifics of the proposal for the tax breaks that Apple is receiving. But I will say that I do have questions. How are we holding them accountable? What does this mean for job creation? Are they creating new jobs in North Carolina? Are they merely transplanting existing jobs to North Carolina? Are we sure that they're recruiting within the state? Are they going to help ensure that people all over the state, for example, have access to workforce training programs so that they can take advantage of those good high paying jobs? Those are a lot of my questions. Suzy, please.
I think that was a really great answer. I don't have a lot to add except to just underline the points that Heba made about companies not just looking at what kind of tax breaks they can get when they're considering a new state in which to do business, but or rather to set up base. But we know that I think it was this week that there was a release from the National Education Association that the state ranks like 33rd in our, and maybe our teacher pay or maybe education more broadly. But I think things like that are also taken into account. So I think leaders in the General Assembly tend to oversimplify and maybe, I'll just say oversimplify some of the values that companies have.
That's very helpful. There was a question about whether Apple did get a big tax incentive to come, but it sounds like we don't know, right? There's not transparency. We know they got something, right?
They did. They got a very large incentive, but what I don't know is how they're being held accountable, if at all. So for example, we see in news reports that they will create, or I think that the wording is a little more opaque than that, but it will lead to the creation mm-hmm. of a large number of jobs. And so my questions are, okay, how are they being held accountable? Are we sure that they're going to be doing that? Are they going to be new jobs? Are they going to be recruiting in North Carolina so that we can ensure that more people in our state can join the middle class, for example? Those are my questions around accountability.
I think they're good questions. I grew up in Austin, Texas, back when it was starting to blow up and kind of became the Silicon Valley of the Southwest. And what Austin realized in a hurry is that it was not built for the infrastructure that was needed with all of the influx of high-tech companies coming in. And so I'm sure that would be a concern for the Triangle as well.
Absolutely. And think about if there are any of you that have been looking for houses lately, you know how competitive the housing market is. So there are all sorts of concerns about that, about, you know, the property values, property taxes. Will people living in North Carolina be able to afford to buy a house? Things like that. So yeah, there are all sorts of tangential issues. So Lou, I know that the reports are that it's conditional on fulfilling their promises, but I wanna know what exactly does that mean? How is that enforced? And how exactly are we holding them accountable?
Well, this is very helpful. We might just remind everyone of the two bills that you relate, well, four bills, both sitting in the House and the Senate, related to the corporate tax rate, but also related to the recovery rebate, to really encourage people to reach out to their legislators to talk about how important these bills are and to keep these moving on track, as we know how quickly these bills can be silenced and die in committee, unfortunately. Are there any other questions that we have for Suzy and Heba? There's a link there more on the Tabor bill that they talked about and probably how bad it was, it sounds like, for the state of Colorado.
Heba, does it make sense to share the link to our action alert around the recovery rebate?
Yes, I'm sorry that I didn't do that. Thank you, Suzy.
No, you're fine. I just found it.
So I would also say, so please remember the tax changes bills. I wrote the numbers. Please remember the Recovery Rebate for Working Families Act. And also, you know, Sean, you bring up a really great point. We have the opportunity right now in North Carolina to begin a discussion so that we ensure that if Apple does sort of usher in a new wave of really large businesses, especially tech businesses coming into our state, then how can we maximize the positive benefit while ensuring that we maintain a good quality of life for our citizens and ensure that these large corporations are paying what they need to?
Absolutely. Thank you, Suzy. Thank you, Heba, for your time this morning, for your expertise. I know that you had shown your email addresses. You may just drop those again in the chat in case anybody else has any other questions that they think of when they go back and rewatch this for all the helpful information that they learned today.
Thank you so much for having us.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you to both of you. And we will close our time together with our litany. God of peace, you have shown yourself to us as one who demonstrated what true power looks like by refusing to use violence. We are willing to follow your way of peace. God of justice, you have invited us into peacemaking work by showing us that justice is the first ingredient. We are willing to work for your way of justice. God of righteousness, you have provided the means for all creation to flourish when we walk your righteous path. We are willing to be your righteous people. Thank you for your time this morning. Go now with God's peace.